Okay, welcome back, guys. We'll continue with the next further topics. So yesterday we walked through the draft of the whole syllabus, and we just came to know what just some background of databases. Today we'll start with the definitions and the other aspects of database concepts. The very first module is starts with the definitions of the terminologies. Then slowly we start with the various architectures, different data models, and we come across some kind of relationships and how do we try to hold relationships in a particular design. So as we started the some kind of definitions in yesterday's class, so database is so it starts with the data, work with data, and complete with data. Everything happens with respect to data only here. All right, so data is what? Data is a piece of collection of relevant data. So only when I say data, data is just a piece of collection of data or relevant information. So what do you mean by database? Database is the collection of related data. Now, same data what we have, we try to perform the relationship in the data. Okay, how we perform relationships, how we have to make them each related, that we will see later on. Okay, in this data, when we try to perform relationships, we need to follow certain procedures or protocols. We call them as constraints. Okay, so when we try to make data to have a certain set of relationship, we make the system to be related following the constraints. All right, so data is a piece of relevant information. Database is a collection of related data. Now, what is DBMS? DBMS is a software which maintains or manages about the creation of the data, defining the data, sharing the data, and manipulating the data. So four main words we need to understand about DBMS software. DBMS is a software which pertains to define the data, construct the data, share the data, and manipulate the data. So DBMS is a simple general purpose software through which we try to perform, we try to play with the database, or we try to play with the related data. All right, so normally when you see any database, it is in terms of table, it is in the form of a specific structure. That structure is always in the form of a table data. Okay, in our databases we use say tables. When we talk about in a different perspectives, we say entity. Same thing in a different way, it is entity, it is a relation, and it is a table. So data is always represented in the form of an entity, and entity will take the shape of a relation, since the tables will be related, and finally relation will turn into a table. Okay, so always the structure of the database is always in the form of a table. So when we start initially, we don't have a fixed boundary. So to fix that boundary, we will collect some, we will highlight a certain part of the world. Say from mini world, we try to collect the requirements. From requirements, we start defining entities. From entities, we try to perform relationships, and we hence we call them as relations. And these relations, we try to create them in the form of tables. Okay, so this how it goes. So when we are starting in initially, we say in terms of entities, Then slowly, when we try to perform a transfer from entity to relations, from relations we transform to a table. Okay, so this is how it goes. So when we always talk about database, it is a fixed particular software, and the language used is SQL, structured query language. We will see the about the overall working procedure of how that system takes care of doing all the building all the applications. In that, you have one major thing as metadata. So metadata, data dictionary, two major concepts we need to understand. That metadata is a kind of abstract information designed for one particular structure. When you create one particular structure of a particular table, one draft of abstract information is generated by the by your system and stored in the system catalog or stored in the data dictionary. Mean what definition you give for one particular application, that structure in abstract way is called as metadata. Okay, and that stores in data dictionary. So whatever activities or we say keywords information or the structure information of a table, or how we write, how we try to deduce the query language, all that is written in data dictionary. Okay, so data will be written in a more abstract manner, or which is represented to the user in a more abstract manner. Actually, this data, everything is stored in the physical layer or say storage devices, but we are trying to access the same content from user level. So data is somewhere, user is somewhere. So that binding takes place in between with respect to certain layers, and the user can view the abstract data. And hence it is called as data abstraction. So the abstraction created for the data, viewed for the data. All right, so it contains large bodies of information. So database in the sense, DBMS in the sense, it contains huge applications. We can create n number of applications with different structures. And everywhere we observe that database in the sense, it is interrelated data or related data amongst the various tables. So you have a certain set of programs to access that data, but all these programs are hidden from the user. Okay, so when we talk about the DBMS, four words definition, when in definition need to understand the four keywords is defining. Defining means how actually you try to define the structure of the data. Defining holds one attribute name. Attribute means it is the property of an entity. What is an entity? Entity is something which is existing in real world. For example, if I consider the student, student is one entity. Entity means it is the real world object, or student is existing in this real world. So I say student is the entity. So in student, I try to define certain attributes. Attributes means it is the property of describing the entity. So when I say student, student holds a name, student holds a university seat number, roll number, semester, and so on. So when I take each individual attribute will be defined with respect to a data type. Data type along with the size, which we say that is a particular domain. So attribute should be specified in a particular domain, and domain means it is the data type along with its size. And all the attributes should inline follow one set of constraint. Constraint means it is the procedure or it is the rules or protocol specified to be followed. For example, University seat number has a fixed style of writing. So I will try to define university number to be unique, and it should be what one particular pattern. That pattern, what I'm trying to specify is define. Okay, so hope I made clear the word defining. So defining in the sense I'm trying to create the structure of a particular entity. Example, as a student, in student I try to create the various entities, like in student I try to create name, USN, say semester, likewise and so on. So they all are attributes, and each attribute will be a specific data type, and data type holds a particular domain with a specific value and size. So when you create that, it is like you are defining. When you add data to it, and you are say constructing with respect to multiple, you try to build many multiple such tables and add the data to it. This constructing. So sharing means you try to share the data with respect to the various credentials. Okay, now credentials means depending on the type of user has logged in, the data will be aligned accordingly. Mean, imagine if you are student, if you have logged into your university marks, you are only provisioned to just check your marks. Imagine if a faculty has logged in, faculty has a privilege to change the marks, but only to with respect to his subject. When it comes to the little more higher authority, maybe head of the department can update any students, any marks pertaining to his own department. Okay, likewise, depending on the type of credential, automatically the sharing of the data happens. Now, same way, manipulating means I am trying to manipulate the data from the disk. Once the data is defined and constructed in the database, I will take that data, and in what way the user needs, I will manipulate that data and give. It's not exactly manipulating or changing the data. It is taking the data raw in the same manner, but how the user wants, manipulate that and give it to him. In our database, for example, imagine I have huge number of data or values in my storage device. I'm not bothered how much or what type of data is present. I am only interested in certain part of data. Okay, for example, imagine you are trying to book a ticket, a train ticket. In there are n number of trains running all over the world, but our intention is not that. I just want to find trains between from one particular source to one particular destination on a specified dates. If I give my query stating that I want to start from one source and end one to one source with on a specified date, what are the trains available? Only that list I will see. Okay, that means at the storage level or database level, there are n number of trains available, but depend on what query we assign, based on that query your system manipulates the data from your storage and gives back to the data what is required for the user. Okay, so that is the meaning of manipulating. Okay, so finally, goals of DBMS is provides a way to store and retrieve database information in a convenient and efficient manner. Retrieve means I am trying to ask the data and retrieve and see the data. Now you check your emails, in the sense you are trying to retrieve your emails from your storage device. Okay, so DBMS provides a convenient and easy and efficient way in order to access your data. Okay, so there are many different facilities provided by your database management system. There are various other languages, data definition language, data manipulation language, structured query language. Actually, to tell you more, there are some additional languages. Like you have VDL, it is called as View Definition Language. Then one more is HDL, High Definition Language. Likewise, there are many languages in one DBMS. Depending on where you try to apply or what type of query you apply, depending on your type of query, these languages change. Suppose if you just want to query your system with any particular query, you are using data manipulation language. If you are trying to create some one structure, or if you are trying to change the structure, you are using data definition language. Likewise, things keep on changing when you enter what type of say query you are type. Sometimes you also have like privileged commands. Privileged commands means you try to assign the privileges for a specific user. They all fall in privileged commands. When we are working in lab, I'll let you know, I'll show you where all these different languages sits. All these languages we try to apply on one particular domain only. Okay, so SQL is the structured query language which we are using, but your type of command changes, and that will tell you which is a privileged command, which is a DML command, and which are DDL commands. If you are trying to apply anything which is related to structure of your table, they all DDL. If you are trying to work on any values of a particular table, then it is a DML, like that. Okay, so security, it is also provides a security features, as I told you just a minutes back. It is an integrity system. Integrity means it maintains a common platform for everyone, and all the data will be bind with respect to what privileges we give, right? So it is an integrated system. We do have concurrency control. Concurrency means it is the simultaneous execution of the system. Concurrent means simultaneous execution. Why this concurrency came into picture is we want to give the better performance, or we want to increase the performance every time. So in order to increase the performance, why don't we run the executions, or why don't we run the transactions in a concurrent manner? This concurrency makes to execute the things in a faster manner. Now imagine some years back where we did not had net banking facilities, or we did not had any UPIs or online banking. The traditional banking was to go to banks or go to ATMs. Before ATMs, we have to go to bank to withdraw or to do any transactions of bank, maybe withdraw or deposit. Every time you go to bank, you have to wait for hours in line the queue and complete your transaction and come back. As ATMs have introduced, we see that the transactions are bit quicker. And as this online banking introduced, the amount of execution of things made in a drastic change, and we observe that there is a huge change in the transactions, where at a fingertips only we can execute everything and we complete everything. All right, so what I'm telling you is the amount of time wasting going to bank and completing the process, that is negligible these days, because we are sitting at one corner, and at our fingertips we are completing all the transactions. All right, so that is where the concurrency came into picture. Now suppose if you are doing any transaction, if there is any failure, so who will take care? Your DBMS will take care by providing backup and recovery facilities. Alright, so backup and recovery facility means, suppose if you are doing any transaction, if there is any power failure, or if there is any system catches a fire, or if there is any catastrophic failure. In even in such failure, the system will make us to lead to a consistent state. So I just want to give you one simple example of what is inconsistent state and consistent state. Now imagine you are doing one online shopping, online banking, or making an online payment for your online shopping. Imagine if you have purchased the product and doing and making the payment. Once you are making the payment, imagine two processes should run simultaneously. That means withdraw from your account should happen and deposit in your recipient account should happen both at simultaneously or one after the other. Now imagine if you are if you have given the amount and everything, withdraw is successful, and what if there is before it could deposit, there was a failure. Now at that particular point, I say it is inconsistent state, meaning amount should be withdrawn successfully, but it should be deposited to the recipient bank, but it did not do because of any failure. So what our DBMS does is, it will identify such type of transaction, stating that okay, in during this transaction there was a power failure, or withdraw was successful from one particular account, before it could deposit there was any failure. So DBMS will identify, okay, this is the transaction which is giving me an inconsistent value. So either if that transaction will be completing by depositing that withdrawn amount, or withdrawn amount will be redeposited to the same account from where it was been deducted. Both ways can be done. So it creates a kind of it resolves the inconsistencies and makes the system always to be a consistent. So remember, whenever we are doing any transaction, always our system should reach to a consistent state. Data cannot be in a inconsistent state. So in during any transactions we observe, it should not be, data should not lead to a inconsistent state. Now one special feature about DBMS is view mechanism. So view is a one special thing called, as we may even say it as a virtual table, or view, it is just like the one particular view what we are trying to view. Now imagine we are trying to do some transactions of or not exact transactions, we are trying to imagine you are looking into one e-commerce application, say Amazon or a Flipkart. Imagine you are looking into that website. When you search any one product, you see n number of things in one window. What all we observe? We observe various things of one particular product, like the product description you observe, reviews you observe, offers you observe, prices you observe, and related items you observe, and what all the other things you have viewed earlier, all those things you can see. When you ask me as a technical person or as a designer of a particular application, the user may be interested in all these information. The user, what all the user requires, everything the user views. But actually speaking, all the information are not from one table. The information is from various, all the data what you are seeing in your window, the data is from different tables. So what the designer does is, it will take the required elements from different tables, create one view and show to the user. Understanding, in one table I cannot view all that data what I am looking into. any website you observe, maybe your Amazon or Flipkart or any other e-commerce website you observe, the data is scattered in different tables. All required data for the user is extracted from different tables and just placed in the form of a view. Okay, that is why that we are doing is, if we try to extract data from multiple tables and keep it, and every time you make a search, you are wasting the resources like anything. Mean every time you are trying to compare some data from all different tables, a clumsy task. So what we do, we write one view table which all things are necessary for this particular table, extract everything from all and display in front of the user. Whatever you are trying to query, you are trying to query with only one table, that is view table. View table is just given for as a virtual table, just to show the user what all the different information is present according based on the what type of product you select. The moment you go for some other operation, that table is seized. Okay, so having that views, we can create the overhead of the executions of your on your system. So to reduce all the overhead, we go with the design of views. Okay, so some draft of DBMS environment, it does provide a environment like hardware, software and other parameters. In our lab, what we had planned is we have client server architecture machines. Why we do in the form of client server architecture is, one system will be holding the client and server softwares, and all the other machines will be acting as only clients. So server will be holding server as well as client softwares, and all the machines will be interconnected with a specific port number in line or configured with the client. This is because you sit on any device, you log into that server from any device, you log into your data. Anytime you log in, you will be receiving your data. Anywhere you sit, there is no change of the data. Suppose if you sit on one machine and work on standalone, and every time you need to set up or configure all the n number of machines, again it is a clumsy task, and the student may change the data of one student to the other student's data. To resolve all that problems, we came with a client server architecture. So whatever you do, you sit in one system and do, that will update in the server. So one, we just have to make changes only in one machine, and the all other systems are done. Okay, so this gives very simple task for us. You sit on any device, you get every time acting to your data, and you will be working on your data itself. Okay, and so we will try to look into these words like schema, sub schema, table, attribute. We'll try to understand, and what are the different types of people is also we'll try to understand, like actors on the scene, workers on the scene, and other things. So there are some other procedures like start, stop, log on, log off, backup, recovery, all those things we'll study in a different manner. So we study, or this is just a simple environment, but in detail we'll study about these. So coming to major pillars of database approaches, characteristics of database approach. So what is this characteristic? Why this database makes so special from others? You see, any database table or any table, it will be in the form of self-describing nature. The table itself says what type of application is that, what type of data is holding. It will give you all the required information the moment you see the table. Okay, so that is the one of the best feature of database, which holds self-describing nature of the database application. Next point is insulation between programs and data and data abstraction. No matter from anywhere you try to access your data, no matter any time you access your data, your programs are so tightly coupled, means the programs are properly insulated that every time you are connecting to your system, accessing your to your own data, and data is viewed in a much more abstract manner. One simple example for this word is, we try to access our emails. We don't know where our emails are stored, in what type of application they are stored. We don't know in what way our data is represented by the system, in what way the client and servers are configured. We are completely unaware. But sitting at one corner, if you are connected to internet, you are able to access your emails, you are able to access to your Google Drive, you are able to access to all your contents, what is there on your drive. That means what, all these programs are properly coupled. Because of these insulation between programs and data, all these things are visible. Okay, and all these things are possible. I hope I made this clear. Insulation between programs and data and data abstraction. So the user is given limited information. What has to be done? Only those things are being shown to the user. Rest all things are completely hidden from the user, and it is completely secured, stored somewhere in the globe. Okay, coming to support of multiple views of the data. We can create multiple views of same data. One user can log in many times as many users and look into multiple views of data, absolutely no problem. It supports multiple views of the data. Multiple views in the sense, I can represent the data in n number of fashions. And finally, sharing of data and multi-user transaction processing. Data can be shared among many users, and concurrent transaction is also possible, and multi-user transaction processing is also possible. Multi-user transaction processing means multiple users acting on same data. Now you are using your UPI or your online banking. Amazon is given to everyone, or at one point of time n number of people can access Amazon website or Flipkart website. N number of people can do that transaction at n number of time, and n number of people can look into the data n number of times. That means what, data is also shared, transactions are also concurrent, and multi-user support is also possible by using databases approaches. All this is possible only with using database approach. So these are the four characteristics of database approach. Then comes two main things, like workers behind the scene and actors on the scene. So actors on the scene are the people who are working with the databases. Workers behind the scene are the people who are trying to create the software. Okay, actors on the scene means these are the people actually working with the software. They are not creating software, but they are utilizing the software in order to create the applications. So when any application is created, one will be acting as database administrator, you know, who have all the privileges of the data to work with any type of query, or to work with any type of data. So database administrator plays a very important, huge role in the organization. He holds the privilege to access any data, and he can alter the data at any time, and he can play with the data. So the people working with database administrators are paid in a very, very high they are maintaining the data in such a way that all crucial data has been are been assigned to him, and they are the people who try to give roles to various people. Okay, so they are the administrators who take care of the whole organization's data. Okay, next comes database designers. These are the people who try to design the applications. Okay, database designers. These are the people who try to design the applications. Okay, understanding? Design the application. Database designers design the application. To design any application, there are some set of rules. So to the rules are to be followed, some procedure have to be maintained. So when they're considering the requirements from any particular client, the database designers, they design one application. One simple one a kind of gesture to you guys. Any application is designed considering the requirements in such a way that at least for next 50 to 60 years, there is no change in requirements. Our requirements will not change for the next 50 to 60 years for one application. Can you think or can you imagine now when any designer designs the database application, he thinks in such a way that for the next 40 to 50 years, there is no absolutely change in the requirements. In that way, the database designers think and design the application. One more user is missing here, that is parametric or naive users. There is one word here. Yes, in end users, you find this word called as naive or parametric users. Sorry for that, I missed one word. I have added there, here I didn't add, right? Naive or parametric users. These are the people who are actually working with the application. Working with the application means how? Try to understand. Remember, if you go to banks, the moment you are going for any transaction, the clerk will be sitting to complete your transaction. So what is their task? Their task is to take the request from you and do accordingly. That means these are the trained people who are well versed with the techniques of utilizing that particular application. Okay, such users are called as naive or parametric users. They are working with respect to the parameters assigned to them. Depending on a specific role assigned to them, their role is to just work with the application. Okay, one is the administrator, one is the designer, the other one is the use the application. Okay, so you have some end users. In end users, again, you have different types like casual end users. Casual end users they walk through the application. They don't have any privileges, but still they can just view the data. Sophisticated end users are the users who try to make decisions based on huge amount of data, like the scientists or weather forecasting information, or they are the people who we call them as system analysts, who try to observe the data and make the decisions based on the data available. Such users are called as sophisticated end users. I also told about naive and parametric users. These are the users who try to work on the applications. Example is the banking bankers who are utilizing the applications and doing your requests. Other example we can quote like the stock brokers who are sitting on their companies and doing the brokerage service, who are giving brokerage services and so on. All those users are treated as naive or parametric users. So standalone users, people like us who have one particular laptop or desktop at our homes and try to build applications where all our data is residing in one computer and we try to work on with that single single system. So we say we talk to them as standalone users. All right, so these are the different actors on the scene, and there are some other people working behind the scene. So these are the people working with this software, right, who try to create the software. So DBMS, system designers and implementers, these are the people who try to design and implement the software. So tool developers are the people who try to develop the tools based on different versions. You have many languages in DBMS. Front end is one different part added. In backend, there are different layers. In each one layer act as a different platform, a different language. All they are created as one specific tool, and these are the people who design the tool or the software. They are called as tool developers. And based on every version, there is an update. Updates are released by these people. And lastly, you have called as operators and maintenance personnel who are only deployed to take care of the operations and maintaining the software. Like in certain companies you observe, there will be people who will sit to maintain the data of a particular organization. Okay, they are just operators and maintain the information of a particular organization. Yeah, these are the people who actually sit behind the system, who creating the softwares, and so they are called as workers behind the scene. So coming to advantages of databases. So I have advantages, limitations, when not to use, for another few more topics for today's class. See, one major thing of databases is in what way it is advantageous to the other terminologies. Like we had file-based systems, or we had some information systems with prior to DBMS. But in file-based or in traditional approach, we find we could not control the redundancy there. Data will be representing multiple times, or multiple times update required, or data may be lead to inconsistency and other issues. But here, in having databases, one major advantage is we can control redundancy. This is one of the major part of our approach, right? Consistency, the data is always consistent. Data will never make us to be in a inconsistent state. Integrity, the data is always makes to have integrity. For example, imagine you have a specific balance in your bank. If you go to ATM, is also same. If you walk through your online online banking, it is also same. Or if you check your balance through UPI, or you go to bank and check, everywhere it is same. It is like the data maintained as integrity completely. Okay, so the data maintains a specific structure. The whole structure is same. Okay, when you look to towards the one application is your Facebook application. Facebook application, no doubt it is one of the big data application. It is not a simple database application. It is the big data application where it comprises of huge tons and tons of data. Okay, so Facebook data is treated as a big data application. Any one picture you take, any one video you take in your Facebook application, all the images are maintaining integrity. All the videos in Facebook are maintaining integrity. That means the structure for all the data is the same. Okay, data is of course heterogeneous. Heterogeneous means you have image data, you have text data, you have audio data, you have video data, data is various types. But for data is one particular type of one type, means audio, all audios are one type, all videos are one type, all images are one type. That means for one specific data type, data maintained its integrity. Okay, to view in a broader picture, data does not have a specific structure in Facebook. Why? Means the information or data for one person is not same with the other, but the structure of arrangement of data with respect to each, it is same. Sorry. Now, the next advantage is security. As I said, security is a major concern. Data should be protected from unauthorized users. All that activities are taken care in our databases. Concurrency control. Even we are trying to check that even if n number of transactions are concurrently executing, we will take care of stating that data should not lead to a inconsistent state. One more point, restricting unauthorized access is equivalent to security. Mean we will never give access to the person who are not at all authorized. All right, so this is one of the important topic or important word to understand: providing persistent storage for program objects. Why I said important is we normally don't think of this particular point in our other programming languages. Now, what do you mean by this persistent storage? Means imagine you are executing in a C program. In C program or C++ program or a Java program, you start your execution, you run the program and you terminate. Once the program terminates, that data is lost. That data is not stored, rather it is lost. Means that data will not provide you persistent storage. But in DBMS, you have persistent storage for program objects. Means data is still holding that persistency. You, anytime you quit from the SQL prompt, anytime you log in, you're still connecting to the data, whichever to any data you can easily or directly access. That is the specialty of databases. So anytime you log in to your any particular, say, imagine you are using any online shopping, say Amazon or say Flipkart. The moment you terminate at the from your app or from your Amazon window, the moment you log in and type something to your search, your data is readily available. That means your data is always stored in a persistent manner to give you access. All right, that persistent storage structures are not available in C or other programming languages. Now you may have a doubt that why now Amazon is also giving me data in a quicker manner, or other things are giving me in quicker manner. They are giving us quicker manner because at the back end they have databases. Okay. Now, providing storage structures for efficient query processing. Now our intention is to provide the structures in such a way that efficient query processing. Efficient means quick time, reliable data. Query processing means I ask for something, that request should go and reach in a short amount of time, and I should receive the response in a much more easier fashion in short amount of time, and the data what I receive should be correct. So I have the storage structures in such a way that my data, every time I am talking to my storage only, and that required relevant data, and every time I'm receiving. So in inter between, there are layers who take care of my efficient query processing. Okay, so I do have representing complex relationship among data. Now, how complex relationship among data, you may have a doubt. Now, I see, or I just tell you one, take a simple example. Now, consider one university application. University application is a huge application. So university holds what? University offers various courses. And courses are in line offered by colleges. And colleges have major departments. Departments offering the courses in line with the universities. And college offers courses to various students. And n number of students study in each college. Okay. Now, the whole application is only one application. Okay. So I take any part in university application I hold, they all hold one relationship, one complex relationship. Now, when I take one table, when I take one student record, student is one entity in the college. College is one entity. Department is one entity. Semester is one entity. Subjects are one entity. So also university is one entity. Only entity I said in one entity holds n number of attributes. N number of attributes holds n number of values. N number of values holds n number of characters. N number of characters holds n number of bits. I'm making you clear. So n number of university holds n number of entities. N number of entities holds n number of entities. In one entity, I have n number of attributes. In one attribute, I have n number of values. In each value, I have n number of characters. And each characters, I have n number of bits. So holding everything together is one particular relationship holding in the throughout the application. All right, so we can just imagine how the relationship is being defined for each one individual component. All these things are related by each other. Now, university holds a relationship with the college. College holds the relationship with the students. Students hold the relationship with the department. Department holds the relationship with the subjects and with the syllabus and so on. So representing all these things with the one common relationship is meant to say it is a complex relationship. All right. So in real words, or in to say it is in terms, it is very difficult, or to say it is a complex, but still it is an easier task in database. So enforcing integrity constraints means I want to follow, or I have to follow, I mean, all my data should be in line following all the constraints. That is the meaning of enforcing integrity constraints. Example is with your USN. In one university, all the USN of all the students are followed in one particular pattern. All right, so I'm trying to enforce all the values of USN of all the students should be same. So that is the constraint, and that is the integrity I'm trying to enforce in one application. Okay, so this is very, very trickier one, permitting inferencing and actions using rules. You have six rules, Armstrong's inference rules, six rules, which we'll be studying in the fourth module. So based on those rules, our data stands. So based on those six rules, our data will be inferencing. So whatever design we create in our applications, all these data in our application should reside or should be in line with the six inferencing rules. And whatever the rules say, accordingly the actions will be specified by the inferencing rules. So it will, all those inferencing rules will be permitting in our relationships. That is the meaning of this permitting, inferencing and actions using rules. So standards can be enforced, as I said, when we try to design applications, we want our data to be designed in a more efficient and form of a particular standard. So we do use normal forms and normalization process to maintain the standard of the application. All right, so we try to enforce this standard in our application. Like as I said in the previous words, like backup and recovery, if there is any problem in the in any execution of any of the systems, we observe that if any power failure happens in midst of the transaction, backup and recovery will take care of the particular task. Finally, data sharing and conflict control. Suppose if you are trying to access do the task for a same object, then conflict may occur. Now what you should understand, what do you mean by a conflict? Two people trying to access data from one person, or two people want to book a train ticket simultaneously on a same train for a same train on a same date, then definitely there will be a conflict, or at one point of time only one transaction will be allowed, later on the other. Till one completes the transaction, the other will be held waiting. So that is the conflict control. Next is productivity, accessibility, economy of scale, maintenance. These are some of the words where the database provides. So there is one more word to say, flexibility is still missing, but we can still have the flexibility of the data. Data may be representing in n number of ways. You change at one side, it reflects the all to all the other sites. It is one of the most flexible system. So some certain limitations, complexity, size, there are certain kind of restrictions where we try to observe, say size is one particular specific, cost also, performance, vulnerability. Okay, so in other terms, why it is complexity? In the sense, you see, we cannot create a database for a DNA application. If the size is too much enormous, I cannot build any applications. Most of the healthcare applications do not have a database application because their structure changes, their we cannot design for any such type of needs. We cannot design an application. So that is a kind of limitation in the database. Size also matters when huge size matters with one to the other. If say, imagine the weather monitoring data cannot be stored in a specific size, so that application cannot be built. So sometimes it depends on cost, software conversion, conversion from one design to the other. Maybe it sometimes it's difficult to design. Performance is always an issue. Vulnerability is always a kind of issue where sometimes the data may be hacked. Sometimes you may not get a performance as well if n number of people trying to scale on and apply on a specific data. So when not to use database? High initial investment in hardware, software and training. Like as I said, DNA application or weather forecasting system cannot be built on a database application. So when oftenly data processing changes, when every time there is a change in the structure of the data, it is difficult to design a database. So if there are any issues by providing security, or you cannot control the concurrency, or recovery is not possible, or integrity functions are not possible, then we cannot go with the database design. So to wrap up, today we have came across definition, we came across characteristics, actors on the scene, and workers behind the scene, and touching upon advantages and disadvantages. All right, so anybody have any questions before we close? Let me take the attendance as well before you guys close. Anybody have any questions? Yes, if anybody have any questions, we can just discuss them, or else we can stop. No questions? Yes? Anybody have any questions? Okay, let me see any chat box, and if there are any questions in the chat box. Okay, you guys can always create some notes in the chat box, or you can just make a note of whatever points have been discussed. All right, so thank you very much for joining. We'll continue in the next class. Thank you so much. You guys can log off now. Thank you.